It is a place where you'd expect an American institution to live. Carmel, California. The landscape is wild, at times heroic. A majestic setting that evokes all kinds of emotions, most of them romantic and passionate. High above the shifting kelp beds lives the American institution. He looks like you'd expect him to look, as American as John Wayne. Larger than life, but still there's a feeling of warmth. He's poetic, but understated and humble. This, then, is Ansel Adams in his 81st year. For a good 70 of them, he has photographed the grand Western landscapes. This is the man who photographs nature's Mona Lisas.
I started photographing the box camera in 1916, just making snapshots, recording what I saw and who I was with and what mountains I climbed. And I was very deep in music at the time. But as I progressed in the time and was continuing with the music, I became more sensitive and was able to see things more intensely.
It was in this very room where a young Ansel Adams performed the works of Bach, Beethoven, and Mozart. He was, in fact, a trained classical pianist, and he studied assiduously. Some said he had a brilliant mind. He was able to study a score, take it to bed with him, and have it memorized by morning. Yet he was restless. Ansel began to take his photography more seriously. Then, about 50 years ago, he had a decision to make. Would it be the camera or the piano?
Camera one. And the family and friends say, oh, Ansel, don't give up the piano. The camera cannot express the human soul. So the only answer I had to that was, well, I don't think the camera can, but maybe the photographer could.
It was his training as a musician that disciplined him as a photographer. Sometimes Ansel said he could hear music in a photograph, not in a sentimental sense, but structurally.
Most color prints, if not almost all, when I see them, they remind me of a piano that's a little out of tune.
It was usually black and white photographs because he said it gave him control. As he photographed more and more, he was seeing more. Then he saw it more clearly. In 1927, while in Yosemite, Ansel Adams took a picture of the magnificent Half Dome, a view from the West Ridge that he feels changed his view of photography. It was his first visualized picture. He had decided in advance how the photo would look. Now it was no longer luck, no longer a hope of a fortunate accident.
Photography can't really exist without the element of visualization. You're photographing surfaces because of light. When the moment's right, you sort of sense something inevitable and you make the picture. The negative is like the composer's score, and the print is the performance.
With that in mind, how would you rate your performance?
Well, I've had a pretty good audience.
Sometimes a waterfall doesn't have to be very big to be very great. Take Fern Spring, for example. This fall was immortalized in a photograph by Ansel Adams taken several years ago. And as you can see, Fern Spring has a drop of about 1 foot.
It was a nice happening, and I came across it and I saw a picture. And it's quite a different technique from photographing Yosemite Falls, but it's the same spirit as this.
An Ansel Adams spirit is there in thousands of America's photographers. He has personally trained nearly 5,000 students. Every year they come to Yosemite, no doubt looking for that moment that Adams called inevitable. Ansel Adams once said of his own work that seeing the photographs together brought back the exhilaration of his youth, the striding in the high places with the heavy camera, absorbing the sound of the wind and the water, and the ever-present benediction of light. But Adams' humility can't accurately describe the magnitude of his contributions to the art of photography. Wrote John Zarkowski, his pictures are all the more precious, for they stand as the last records for the young and the future of what they missed. For the aging, for a little while, they will be a souvenir of what was lost.
I think we forget the fact that there is such a thing as a moment all by ourselves is precious.
It's a corny question, but what would you like most to be remembered for?
Well, I guess a few good photographs. What else can you say?